The question is, what am I dosing? In here, I have... Hey, what's up, reefers? Today, I'm going to answer the top 5 questions asked regarding the $146 budget nanotank build. Since you've been following this channel, you know that the $146 budget nanotank build has been up and running for close to 1 year. With the tank being up for 1 year, I feel like now is the time to put together a video regarding these top asked questions, because some of these questions are actually really good and is applicable not only to this tank, but as well as other Reef tanks. So without further ado, let's just jump into it. Question number one, how do you like the AquaClear 70 filter? And specifically, how is the Refugio mod that you did working out for you? All right guys, so behind the 10 gallon budget nano tank is the AquaClear 70. Thank you, Emily, for the light. She's holding a spotlight right here so we can see it. For the past year, the AquaClear 70 has been working fantastic, beautifully for the budget 10 gallon tank, but this review is about the Refugio mod that I did. As you remember, I cut up a piece of plastic that came with the filter to divide up the back chamber to two sections. One section contains a heater and a media section, and the other section contains macroalgae as well as a whole bunch of marine pure spheres right here. In my experience in this system, the marine pure spheres is fantastic. It houses all kinds of bacteria, and I swear this is one of the reasons I can overfeed my tank. The macroalgae, not so much, because it did not grow at all for me. I did not recommend this light at all because it's not really growing the algae, but it may be a nutrient issue. In terms of macroalgae, if I were to set up the system again, I would probably just kind of forget about the macroalgae and rely on something else to remove the phosphate, which is this right here. So this is a bag of GFO that I use. Replace this every like 3 to 4 months. And I try to take this out of the tank whenever possible. If I start seeing a brown diatom on my sand bed, usually means that my phosphate is a little bit high or there's something else going on, and I'll toss in a bag of GFO. And usually that will clear up the diatom within a week or two. And I understand that some of the products like the Chemipure Blue also contain GFO, carbon, and stuff like that, so they're kind of similar. But I'm just running GFO to remove any excess phosphate. In terms of filtration, it gives enough flow for the tank. As you can see, all the things are moving, and this is not even on a high setting. It can go a little bit stronger. Question number two that I get a lot is, are you still using the Aqua Knight A029 lights? If so, what setting are you using? Thank you again for the spotlight, Emily. Another really popular question is this light right here. This is the Aqua Knight A029. People asking, are you still using it? How do you like it? What setting do I use? That's actually one of the top questions. Blue is 100% for sure, because I really like the color pop. So it's more the white than the tweaking. This is like full blue and full white. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Usually six. I'll tap it 6 times. I like to call it about like 65 to 75% white and then 100% blue, and I just find it more pleasing. There's really no rhyme or reason to it, but this light is fantastic and the color rendering is fantastic. Some of the big question is like, how good is this light actually? Is it capable of growing corals, and what type of corals? The soft corals are doing beautiful. Look at this guy. That's the Japanese green weeping willow. That's a finger letter from down there. The LPS are really happy. And for example, look at the frog spawn, look at the kryptonite candy cane, all the feeding tentacles out, look at the acants. The challenge comes when it comes to anemones and SPS. So these are the rose bubblesoup anemone. As you can see, they are reaching for the light a little bit, not too badly. They haven't really tried to move all the way up and reach for the light up here. So that tells me that it's probably getting enough light. And I supplement it with feeding. Now with SPS, I have a, this is actually a green Montipora cap up here. It is not really thriving. You do see some growth at the edge, but then the Monty cap doesn't really require higher light. This is a more lower demand SPS, and it's kind of holding steady. So I feel like this light may be okay with the less light demanding SPS like the Monty cap, bird nest, and stuff like that. I'm not sure if this can handle like a Acropora and stuff like that. In general, for what we're paying for this light, which is like $69, this is a tremendous value. It has been a year or so already, and as you can see, the corals are happy. They're really happy in this light. So yeah, definitely recommend it. I almost want to distribute this light if possible. Might probably make some like modification to the mounts and stuff like that, but this light has been Really nice find. Thank you to the guys on Nano Reef for recommending this light. Oh, by the way, we are testing this clamp. Basically, there's two really big requirements. Number one is light, number two is the water parameter, actually three, and number three is feeding, especially at this size. So far, so good. It has been about a week. This little clamp actually came from downstairs. It's not really growing downstairs, but then it seems to be doing well. So I figured I'd just bring it up here and see if he likes it a little bit better here. We'll see how it goes with this light.
Question number three. If budget is not a big concern, what are some other equipments that you recommend getting for this budget nano tank built?
Okay, another question I get a lot is what are some other upgrades that I recommend for a nano tank like this? Oh, thank you again, Emily. Another question. Another question that I get asked a lot. The first thing I would recommend is a auto top-up system. So I have a smart ATO. You probably can't see it because it's tucked away so well. The sensor is actually right underneath the AquaClear 70. It fits perfectly under this little dimple right here. So it's hooked up. Let me backtrack a little bit. Do you guys know what an ATO is? It's basically, it has a level sensor that detects the water level. If the water level go under the sensor level, it basically pump water from this little container. This is fresh water, and it'll spit some fresh water out in the filter, and it'll bring the whole water level back up here. This is really, really important for a reef tank, because like as water evaporate, right? It's only the fresh water that evaporates. The salts remain in the system. That means that you'll get a salinity swing. When salinity changes, all the parameter changes, especially the water volume is so low in a nano tank like this. So if you do not have an ATO system, you always want to make sure you're topping off the fresh water, you'll mark it off, you want to make sure the water level is always there. But with ATO like this, man, life is just so much easier. So if you are thinking about buying anything else for the nano tank, auto top-off system and a water jug or water container. Second thing I really like about this budget nano tank that I added is this guy right here. This little black piece of acrylic right here. This is a magnetic overflow created by Ocean Box Design. Man, I can't speak today. Ocean Box Design, they create a lot of like innovative products, and this is a really nice magnetic overflow box that kind of just like magnetically be held in place. You see the magnet back there? It's actually designed just for the AquaClear. They have it for like the AquaClear 30, 50, 70. This is a 70. And what you do is like you take out the intake tube at the end and just kind of slide this into place. Everything just like fits beautifully and is not permanent. Again, it's magnets. The reason I do this is because I have some like surface scum across the top. So I want to make sure the water is being pulled out from the surface. This way we'll get the oil slick down in there into the filter. The other benefit is that sometimes I'll get these bubble tip anemones start wandering around the tank, and they may get sucked up to the intake tube. Thankfully, I was able to catch it a couple times, and since then I have like a foam intake, a foam pre-filter on the tube, but it looks ugly and I have to clean it all the time. So I've been eyeing this guy right here. This thing is not cheap. I think it's like 60 or 70 bucks, but thankfully Mighty Nano Tank had one and he upgraded his tank, so he doesn't need this anymore. He gave it to me. And once I started using it, I'm like, man, why did I not buy this a little bit earlier? First of all, it makes the tank look so clean. Second of all, it clears out the surface scum. And thirdly, it also helps with the bubble tip to make sure they don't get sucked up. So that's the second thing I'll recommend. Now, the third thing I really like is actually this guy right here. This is a tool. This is the Flipper Nano. I have the Flipper regular 40-45 dive, and I really, really like it. I've been using it for almost 2 years now, and I did not need to replace the blade. Nano, I have a little bit shorter than that, and I really like it. Ow, I almost, oh my god, that hurt. So as you can see, the magnet is decently strong. To be completely honest, I do like the regular a little bit better, simply because the strength of the magnet is a lot stronger for the regular, and it just cleans things up nicely. With the Flipper Nano, it still does a really good job, but it's not as strong as the regular one. I tried the regular one on the nano tank, but the glass is a little bit too thin, so it's a little bit too strong. I feel like I'm so afraid I'm gonna scratch the glass, but it's a little bit harder to move. This is a little bit softer, not as sticky. So sometimes I may do one or two or three passes to clean out a certain spot, especially with Caroline algae, but it does do a good job. And with a tank this small, it's not a big deal to kind of go over two or three times. So out of all the magnetic scraper that I've used, I really, really like the Flipper brand. Big fan of the Flipper regular, and the Flipper Nano, it's awesome as well. So that's the third things I recommend.
The fourth question is really popular as well. What do you dose in this tank if anything.
If you look at the core density, it's pretty dense. So a lot of people are like, oh, are you dosing anything? If so, what are you dosing?
I do have a doser. This is the CoralBox WF01, the world's smallest single channel doser. This little doser is really nice. I was testing it, really reliable, easier said. But the question is, what am I dosing?
In here, I have Tropic Marine's Alpha Reef. Basically, it is equal parts alkalinity, calcium, and magnesium. It contains all kinds of trace elements in there. So basically, this one solution is enough for everything that your reef tank needs. So I've been dosing it. However, I dose a really, really tiny amount. So like it's like 4 milliliters per day or something like that, spread out through the day. I'm using the dosing pump. To be 100% absolutely honest, you really don't need to dose anything for a tank this size. I'm really pretty much doing it just to test the doser. I don't have a lot of SPS in here. I don't plan to keep a lot of SPS. And everything that these kind of corals need, they get it enough from water change. Now, I know this question is going to come up. It's like, oh, what kind of salt do you use? At the moment, I'm using Fritz salts. They've treated me really well, and I have zero issue with Fritz salts at all, so I've been using it. And the parameters that they mix at is what I'm going after as well, so it works out well, so I've been using Fritz salts. However, things may change a little bit since I have a clam in here already. So it may suck up some of the calcium if it starts growing. But based on its growth rate, which is really, really low in a 45 gallon, I kind of doubt it. So I think water change is fine.
And for our fifth and final question, how do you attach frags to your rock work?
So attaching frag, it really depends on what are you trying to attach. Now, I typically really hate the look of frag plug. So unless I really need to, I don't stick the frag plug in there. But I tried that with Zoas, as you can see right there. With frag plug, I try to find any naturally occurring hole in the rock, put some super glue in there and just jam in there. And usually they do pretty well. And over time, they do cover up the frag plug. However, they do have a little raise there. This little, you can kind of see it. So what I like to do is actually scrape off the Zoas from the frag plug, ideally with a little bit of the frag plug connected but without the whole big thing, and then super glue them onto the rock directly whenever possible. But of course, in certain cases like that, where I don't want to risk pulling the whole frag off the plug, I just stick the plug in there, hoping that the frag will eventually overtake that little plug. And when you come to LPS and stuff like that with a branch, I just kind of place the branch. I just find a place where the branch lock in well and just kind of rest it on there. Same thing with the frog spawn, because those stuff I tend to move around a little bit, especially since I have these bubble tip anemone in the tank. In case they wander, I could easily just pull the whole thing and move them around. So with branching LPS, I just leave them be. The agans I got, they also sit on a frag plug. So as you can see, I just find a hole that can somewhat fit the plug, and then use these kind of glue to stick them in place. And for glue, I use the Polyp Lab coral glue. It works really well. But then most of the glue that's on the market works well. Also the ones from the dollar store, as long as you use the super glue gel, they all tend to work pretty well. A specific glue like the Polyp Lab one, in terms of designing the tubing, they do spend a little bit more thought on it. As you start using it, you'll see that, oh, okay, they actually think about certain things, like it being used underwater. So when you let go, it doesn't suck the water back into the tube. So there's a lot of little things that make it a little bit better. But for the most part, super glue is super glue. Just make sure I super glue gel. When mounting Gorgonian, one thing I do is that on a fresh cut, I will shave off the skin at the bottom of the Gorgonian, the part that's gonna go into the rock. And then I'll dab some super glue on it, super glue gel, put it in the rock and just hold it in place until the super glue gel kind of hardened a little bit. So that's how I mount all these. The reason I do that is because, like, if you include the skin in the hole and super glue around it, the skin eventually is going to decay, die off, and then this frag will loose again and may float off. The other really interesting way I mount these kind of finger leather that I used to do from way back is actually jamming a toothpick right in the middle. Just jam it right in there. And then now I get a little stock, right? A solid stock, and I can just stick that stock in a hole, or I can use a rubber band to tie the stock down. It's way better than just trying to work with that skin, because it'll slime up and it'll slide away. It's hit or miss with some people, but I've had a lot of success with that kind of method. Same thing with how that's actually how I mount it here. So the skin is already attaching to the rock, and that's what we want. And there's a piece of wooden toothpick right in the middle. Doesn't seem to be bothering the soft coral, and it seems to be working well. So as you guys know, this tank has been up for about a year already, and usually this is when things get fun. Because like at the year mark, the tank has been through the ugly phase and it has built up enough bacteria colony, and whether the marine pure spheres on along the rock and all the surfaces, where it's really a lot more forgiving to changes. This is when I'll start packing in the corals, as you can see I've started, and I will start adding more livestock. Up to this point, the bio load is really, really light. It's just sexy shrimps, crab, and recently I added this tiny little clownfish, but I may add one more tiny clownfish like this, so this little dude will have a little buddy, and maybe a tiny goby. In terms of the bio load, for a nano system like this, I try to keep it as low as possible. When I start seeing diatom all the time, even with GFO in there, then that's when I know that I have trouble. If I see cyanobacteria, then I know that I'm in real trouble, because that means that there's some really hardcore excess nutrient locked up in this system. We're gonna start stashing corals in here. I know this tank is called the budget built, but we're gonna add some pretty interesting coral in there, and some of them may not be so budget. I just wanna show that a reef tank does not need to be expensive. Again, this whole system, the light, the tank, the filter, the heater, is $146. I've added certain things that's a little bit more expensive, for example, the overflow box, which is about, I think like 70 bucks, 70 or 80 bucks. I've added the auto top-up system, which is $120. The container is about 70. The doser, I think they go for $50 or $60 or so. But these are all not essential. It would be really nice to have at least the auto top-up system, but these are, again, not essential. All you need is this, and you're good, and you can get a tank like this. So that's kind of like what I want to prove with this setup, is that a reef tank does not need to be expensive. Of course, like if you are willing to add a little bit more money, a little bit more time to it, it can make your life a little bit easier and things may look a little bit cleaner because you can hide certain things. Alright guys, I hope these answers has been helpful to you, whether you're doing a budget nano build similar to this one or just reefing in general. If you enjoy content like this, be sure to leave a like on the way out so I know that you guys actually like informational content like this once in a while, so it's not straight up all vlogging or me just going nuts. Reefpalooza is next weekend. I can't wait to see some of you guys there. And I can't wait to bring you other stories and adventures. See you next week.
Reefers.
Well, there we go. All right, guys, let's talk about the filter first.